When I was about 15, I saw the movie Drive with Ryan Gosling, and I liked that movie quite a lot. I thought it was compelling. It had a killer soundtrack, decent plot, and also the most cheesy Sigma main character ever, who I thought was pretty cool. So after having seen that movie, I was on vacation for a while, and I was in an elevator by myself about to go up to the floor where my family's room was, when this middle-aged guy gets on the elevator with me. And then I get this moment where I remember the specific and incredibly unimportant scene in the movie where Ryan Gosling asks Carey Mulligan's character what floor she's going to so he can press the button for her. And so I ask this guy what floor, I press the button for him, and then we reach his floor and he gets off. And as I'm riding up the rest of the way to my own floor, I suddenly think to myself, oh my gosh, I am just like Ryan Gosling. After remembering, and more cringing at this moment later on, I realized that the reason that the driver appealed to 15-year-old me is because he towed the line between cheesy and serious, exaggerated and perfectly human. And after some more reflection, I also realized that some of my personal favorite video games are incredibly fucking goofy as well, and much more to an extreme degree than Drive.
Bad kitty! I was so worried about you!
I genuinely feel like I need to be prescribed Ritalin.
So here's a video on some cheesy ass video games that, honestly, I wouldn't change in any way. A video game has to fulfill a player's personal fantasy much more than a movie does. You can play a video game in really however way you want, but you can only really watch a movie one way. And to keep your attention, games often have to be highly exaggerated and over-the-top bullshit. And you can't mention over-the-top bullshit without mentioning Devil May Cry. The series was literally made because Capcom tried implementing this crazy combat system into early versions of Resident Evil 4. And instead of scrapping the idea, they made a whole new video game. And now, Devil May Cry is known as having some of the most insane and cheesy bullshit in all of gaming. Although I've only played the fifth Devil May Cry, it left quite the impression on me. The game flaunts its craziness to an extreme degree, stretching your engagement to the point where it almost challenges you to keep up with the fact that its story makes zero sense. Allow me to run through the story here. Alright, so the villain. Who is this demon man that looks like the one guy from Strange Thing. Just chills in the arena, first three quarters of the game. Till suddenly he turns into Dante's brother, and then he turns Earth into a Dr. Seuss tree. Then Dante ends up fighting an eagle/chicken, a panther, and a golem who are manifestations of Virgil's angry thoughts and are the main source of combat when you play as V in the first half, who is actually the human half of Virgil who uses those funny manifestations to fight while he sits around reading fucking George Orwell. Are you following me here? No? Well, it doesn't matter, because Devil May Cry is super effective at keeping gameplay and story separate, so much so that you could disregard the cutscenes entirely and just play it for the combat. In fact, for just $5 extra, the game allows you to take your disregard for the story even further and replace all the cutscenes with pre-visualized nonsense. This doesn't mean that the story is terrible or that no one enjoys it, but in the end, the game wants to put at least a majority of your focus on the action, which I found to be a lot of fun. Despite the fact that the later sections of the game get insanely hard without any real warning, I still think that Devil May Cry 5 is a game that everyone should at least try. Metal Gear Rising Revengeance seemed unassuming to me before playing it. I'd heard good things about Metal Gear before, but I had not played any of the games, and I wasn't really familiar with the plot of the series. Kojima really worked hard to develop a narrative world in the series, but I was simply unaware of what the games truly entailed. And it turns out what Metal Gear truly entailed was the most convoluted story in gaming. Much like Devil May Cry, Metal Gear Rising Revengeance gets super out there with its story, but I found the narrative to be much more of a positive this time around. Why? Because the two games occupy two spaces with their stories. Devil May Cry 5 has a convoluted bullshit story. But Metal Gear Rising has a convoluted bullshit story that is so crazy, you can't look away from it. I said earlier that the story of Devil May Cry was strong in the sense that you can tune it out from your mind, and the strength of Metal Gear's is that its story cannot be tuned out. It's like the silliest car crash you have ever seen. The secret organization that serves as the antagonist is comically evil.
Africa's just getting a bit too peaceful. What?
The game keeps throwing villain after you going, oh yeah? Well, that wasn't even the real bad guy. And then you kill them and they're still like, haha, that guy was working for this other bigger guy. Until finally, you get to the final boss and it culminates into the most insane fight with the most evil guy ever. And I think that the memes speak for themselves with how iconic this fight and the game as a whole have become in recent times.
Memes. We can rebel against our memes.
Your memes end here.
Oh, fuck off. I love Resident Evil 7. It's the second Resident Evil game I played, coming right after 4. 4 was more of an action game, so it eased me into the series, and then I took the full dive into madness with 7. Resident Evil as a series is interesting, because it has massively inconsistent tone. Resident Evil is largely known as horror, but it's rare for a game in the franchise not to have some silly bits in there. To my friend who has only played the first hour of 7, the Resident Evil games are the scariest games known to humankind. And to me, who has played all of these, the Resident Evil games are jam-packed full of jokes and uncanny moments, but are also the scariest games known to humankind. It's how quickly that Resident Evil is able to get you shaking in your boots again after these cheesy moments that is what makes it as fun as it is. Those moments of transition between having the time of your life to fearing for your life is Resident Evil at its prime. Running from Jack Baker in the main house of Resident Evil 7, or creeping through the hallways of Raccoon City Police Station in Resident Evil 2 are all fond memories for me, but they also exist adjacent to moments like this.
Do me a favor and stay dead.
Overall, Resident Evil is able to present not only some of the best horror gaming around, but also some of the best comedy gaming around, and I like it that way.
Welcome to the family, son.
I used to find myself groaning at the cheesiest of games, but now I find that developers are often too afraid to make a game that embraces its own silliness, and instead make a game with no goofy moments at all that still ends up being silly because it takes itself so seriously. In the end, a game is exactly that, a game, and failing to recognize that the medium in itself is a little cheesy is what makes a game's downfall. When you avoid the cheesiness, you ultimately attract it. And then you start to turn into Drake. Drake is a man who needs to keep a pristine public image, as he'd be out of a job without one. How he manages to stay relevant is beyond me, but he has been in the spotlight for a long time. Keeping up a life of constantly trying to look cool not only changes a person, but it changes the public's perception of that person too. I'm not sure if people are just tired of Drake after him topping the charts for 15 years, but it is pretty funny to see this man do the exact kind of things that would make the public describe him as a silly guy. From his beef with Fantano to some questionable at best rap lyrics, Drake is slowly being succumbed to a pit of goofiness in which he may never escape. Also, his cookies suck, but that's besides the point. What I am getting at is that games should strive not to be like Drake, who prove that pretending to be hard and tough can be for nothing if you fail to embrace your cheesiest moments. If developers embrace the freedom of the medium of video games and implement whatever goofy stuff they want, games are often better for it. Just please, whatever may happen, do not let Drake direct the next Devil May Cry.
Do me a favor and stay dead.